There are some interesting developments in sustainable investing in the Asian region. Arnout van Rijn is Robeco's CIO Asia Pacific. Welcome, Arnout. Arnout, what sustainability trends are you seeing in Asia?
Well, it's actually very interesting because from a Western perspective, sitting in Europe, it's often thought that Asia is lagging far behind and that not much is moving, people have no interest. That's clearly not the case. What we've seen over the last decade or so is already that from China, there's been a lot of top-down movement to start to get things going. And that top-down eventually also filtered through into the bottom-up. So that more and more companies are now also listening to these demands to at least be more transparent, to be more careful with that. In the past, I still remember the stories when I looked at China in the late 90s, early 2000s, that there was some evidence that utility companies and coal companies needed to use scrubbing technology, but then nobody really policed whether they used them or not, and they felt it was too expensive to use them, so they just switched them off and they could make more money like that. That is clearly a thing of the past, right? Governments are now all over these companies to make sure that they behave and that they comply with the demands that the government has on their carbon emissions, for instance. So there's clearly a push from top down that has resulted also in a lot of bottom-up compliance with this. And of course, it also comes from the people. Right? The people in China were clearly appalled by what was going on in Beijing, and you must have seen the pictures about air pollution. And so the government needed to listen to that also. They needed to clean up the skies. And I still remember when I was young in the 80s, there was a similar picture painted from Tokyo in Japan. Now, that was such a dirty city to live in. Now it's one of the cleanest cities in Asia. So you definitely see that grassroots movement is having an impact on the eventual decision making and therefore also eventually on what happens from a sustainability point of view in Asia.
Now, it's interesting you say that because indeed one tends to have the impression that there are plenty of sustainable investing opportunities in developed markets such as Europe. Now, what about Asia? Are you finding enough opportunities in the region?
Yeah, definitely you do. And those are not always the most obvious ones. But what we're seeing, for instance, is that in Asia, being at the forefront of the technological development and always having been very good at manufacturing, that in terms of clean manufacturing, clean technologies, building your computer in a cleaner way, that they are often very much leading in that effort. So we find, particularly in the technology part of our portfolios, that there's quite a number of companies that really contribute to reducing carbon emissions and making sure that their behavior is much better than it has been in the past, also from a social perspective, labor conditions, et cetera, have improved quite a bit. And like I said, there's been much more policing around that too. So that really has had an impact. And therefore you find often quite some hidden gems in Asia that are not the most obvious ones, but are definitely playing a role in that. Another example would be in the automobile manufacturing industry. That yes, of course, there's Tesla, but don't forget that Toyota is actually the first company that came out with cars that were actually able to drive on batteries. So the technological development there is super advanced already, and they're just thinking of the next step, and they will soon overtake Tesla, I'm sure. And similarly for also in the manufacturing side, a company in Korea, Hyundai, has been really very much at the forefront of the hydrogen movement in car manufacturing. So yes, there's clearly a lot going on in Asia.
We frequently hear that sustainable investing relies heavily on data. Now, is there enough good quality ESG data to inform investing in Asia, Arnout?
Yeah, that is still something that's a work in progress. So like I said, it started from the top down and the bottom up is only starting to happen now. What you clearly see is that regulators are also starting to make a big impact. Stock exchanges are also asking companies to disclose these numbers because that's often the issue. It's not that they don't want to disclose, it's just that they've never done that. So when we engage with the companies in our portfolio, there's often a very quick win to be made and said, hey, we're actually looking for these kind of data. We can't find it on your website, it's not in your annual report or in your integrated report, so why don't you publish it? And they said, oh yeah, we can do that. And then, suddenly, indeed, the company looks much more transparent. So, Asian companies need to be reminded because, indeed, they did start somewhat later, but it's definitely happening. And through the engagement with companies that we have, we can really make a big difference as portfolio managers to get that thing even higher off the ground.
There's been some concern about the level of hype around sustainable investing generally, and therefore about the risks for asset prices. Now, as a value investor, what are your views on this?
Yeah, I was going to say, as a value investor, that's very close to my heart. I do see some hypey subsectors, but it's really restricted to some hot thematics. And don't forget also that difference between Western and Asian investors is often that they are, in many cases, not investing in equities for the long run. So they will look for that quick win. So they will jump on bandwagons. And that's been happening in some very hot sectors, like indeed the batteries and the solar power, etc., which has become a very hypey segment. But what the way to deal with that also as a value investor is that, yeah, we look at these trends. Sometimes we think they are exaggerated expectations, and then we will move out of these stocks or at least reduce our exposure. But what's also clear is that investors that have a short-term orientation will often only invest in the pure play companies. The companies that do nothing else are often young companies, and therefore lead to massive multiple expansion that we think is really exaggerated. So we won't invest in those stocks. We will find opportunities though in stocks that have exposure but are not pure play companies. Like I mentioned, in the manufacturing industry, like Toyota and Hyundai, of course they also still manufacture traditional cars. But their future is clearly secure because they're also at the forefront of the next generation of automobiles. So that's often where you move away from the hype and you can still find good valued investment opportunities that still bring the growth that you're looking for then.
Arnout, thank you.